Hey, baby. My husband is on, y'all. Two more minutes. I'm not gonna wait for everybody to get on because I'm gonna leave it up so you can go back and look at it at your leisure. And of course, I'm gonna be transporting the video to YouTube as well. One more minute. Bestie Boo. Robert. Another Robert's on tonight. My bestie Robert Williams is on. What's up, bro? Morris. Roulette. Hey, boo. You're small, right in front of me. Craig, what's up, bro? What's up, everybody? Greetings to you. Daryl Strowman, my brother's on. Hey, everybody. Thank you. Let me start by saying thank you. Thank you, everybody, for your support, your Cash Apps and all of that. Can somebody please type in my Cash App? I put it on the flyer, but I didn't do it on the title. It's $ Eric B. Davis. For those that like to sow into the ministry, I thank you. God bless you for sowing into this ministry. Y'all gonna see some stuff that's happening with y'all money too. Real soon. To make these broadcasts a little bit more professional. At the request of my husband, I decided to change the background today. So today I'm in my dining area. I can't even show y'all all of this bling. If you know my husband, you know that this dining area is all glammed up. Everything in here shines. My husband likes to shine, so yeah, all of this stuff in here. So I'm in here. So the lighting is better. Also, and the devil got busy. My ring light broke right before I got ready to start recording, so I'm gonna have to get another ring light too. So I got a little small one in here just to make it look a little bit bright. Y'all know I got this chocolate skin. I ain't trying to look like Florida Evans. Bless her heart. But we're going to go ahead and jump in tonight. Again, thank everybody for your support and your love. As long as I have people's lives that are changing, as long as I keep getting these messages of how blessed people are, I'm going to continue to do this. I really didn't think that this would take off the way it has. I had no clue. I swear I didn't. No clue that this was going to get the response that it got. Just from me posting a picture of me in a collar and telling a brief synopsis of my testimony as a same gender loving male that's called to ministry. I had no clue that it was going to get this type of reaction. However, I thank God for it. Hey, son. I thank God for it, and I don't take it for granted. It's nothing that I'm doing. I'm not perfect. I'm no different than anybody else. I just had the balls. I had the guts to just tell my truth and do it publicly. At this point, I'm just not ashamed of who God has made me to be. Yeah, God did this. He did all of this. God does everything on purpose with purpose in mind. So everything that I've endured, everything that I've survived was on purpose, and it had purpose behind it. So everything, me being molested, me being humiliated, me being talked about, me being betrayed, thrown away, left for dead, all of that stuff was purposed by God. So, I mean, I was telling a friend of mine earlier today, I don't take nothing for my journey. I wouldn't trade nothing. I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey. It was hard, but I survived it. And in the words of Cicely Tyson, if you survived it, then that means you're that much more powerful. You're that much more skilled in that area. So tonight, the first 2 weeks we've been talking about just being called and being living in your truth. And it's still the same subject, but we're trying to progress in this thing. My mission is not for everybody to come out, not for not everybody to be public with their sexuality or the way they love or what have you. That's not my goal. My goal is to get these people that have been thrown away, that were second-guessed and that were sat to the side because of their sexuality. And you got a lot of people who've been wounded and hurt in church because of their lifestyle that they live, the way that they love and so forth, however you want to put it. And it's time for me to get those people out the bleachers and get them on the sideline so they can get in the game. My bishop told me a while ago that God had a word in my mouth, and there's a people that need to hear the word from me. No matter, my pastor can preach, my bishop can preach heaven down, but he even said that there's a people that need to hear the word from me. Even if he articulated the best way he possibly could, it still needed to be said by me, because people want to hear stuff from somebody that has been in the space that they've been in. You feel me? So I'm going to just jump into that. We're going to talk about this. What's next? What's next for this man, this same gender loving man of faith? What's next for this same gender loving woman of faith? Y'all probably going to ask who made this. Y'all know my husband made this. This vest is a Jeffrey's Mark collection, and I just wanted to wear my husband tonight. He's upstairs in the tub soaking. He's on here live. Baby, say hey again. But I wanted to just make mention of that. Please support his business. Those of you who haven't already, do not die and go to heaven until you get a Jeffrey's Mark piece. I'm plugging my husband in. Yes, I am, because he's good like that. So if you want something nice, men, women, you want something real nice and tailored to you that you may not see on nobody else, because it may be almost alike, but it ain't going to be the exact same. Get something. Jeffrey's Mark. I think it's www.jeffreysmark, JeffreysMarc.com. And go and purchase something. Y'all know how to find them on Facebook and Instagram. All right. So what's next? What's next? Okay, Eric. So I'm living in my truth. I've accepted what it is about me. And I'm called. God has called me. God has a mandate on my life. What do I do next? So the next step is identifying yourself. You got to identify yourself. Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Identify yourself. Who are you? What do you identify yourself with, or how do you identify yourself? Are you bisexual? Are you trisexual? Are you homosexual? Either way, it's a part of your truth. It's who you are. And you need to be able to look in the mirror and own who you see in the mirror. Every flaw, every imperfection, all of that. Own what you see. Every roll, every wrinkle, every patch of hair missing, extra patch of hair. Own it. You got to own it. Own it. So the main concern that I have with most men or women in the church is fear. That's my main concern with a lot of people who will not live in their truth. You're fearful. And that fear is the fear of losing everything that you've built. I can only speak for me and what happened with me. Although I was same gender loving, I was in public. I was very private with my lifestyle. So I was very discreet. I wasn't sneaky. I wasn't in the closet. I was just discreet. I didn't publicize who I was dating at the time or what have you. I was just very discreet with my boyfriends that I had at the time. And I was discreet because I had built such a name for myself as a minister of music. I had built such a name for myself as a singer, as a worship leader, as a choir director, all of that, as a preacher. I had already developed a name for myself, and because I knew what type of field of work that I was in, because I was full-time ministry, I kind of shied away from who I really was and didn't really, you know, just do everything public because I was trying to be discreet. People could only handle what they can handle. And I was trying to keep that a little discreet because I didn't want to, I didn't want to mess up. I didn't want to lose everything. Working in church was my livelihood. So if I was not able to live in my truth, If I was living in my truth and I was honest with who I was in public with it, you saw pictures of me in the club, you saw pictures of me and my dude or whatever, that would have kind of cut back on my money because I'm working in a traditional Baptist church or traditional church period, non-denomination, whatever. I was working in a church, so I couldn't be public about that unless it was an affirming ministry, and it wasn't. So I couldn't be public, so I couldn't love out loud. So I shied away from that stuff because I didn't want to lose the image that I had built. I didn't want to lose all of this time and tenure that I had put in to music ministry. So I didn't want to lose that. So I kind of shied away from who I was and kind of hid it from people. You feel me? Okay, so the main issue is you are still trying to hold on to the image that you made in church and not the image that you've made in the kingdom or the image that you have in the kingdom. So it's easy for us to be fearful of losing the image and the position that we've created for ourselves because that's pleasing to man. That's you getting clout. You got clout. You got recognition. You have this position in your religious organization, Church of God in Christ, Full Gospel, what have you. You can't live in your truth because you got this position. And if you are public about who you are and the way that you love, you're subject to lose those engagements of preaching, lose those engagements of singing and workshops and so forth, because we can assume that you gay, but you can't confirm it. You're not supposed to confirm it, but you can sneak around and we can assume and guess all we want to. But the minute that you confirm what the people are thinking, then it's a problem. That's a whole nother discussion. So let me show you the difference between the images that you have. Your church image versus your kingdom image. Your church image is a title or a position with duties and responsibilities given to you by your pastor or voted in by the people that you lead or the people that you serve. This position can come and it can also end at the discretion of the person that has the authority to hire and fire you. That's a church image. A kingdom image is the image that is given to you before you were born. The plan for you, the mandate on your life that was already put in place before you were formed in your mother's womb. That's a kingdom image. Nobody can take that from you. If you focus on who you are in the kingdom versus who you are in church, then you'll know the difference. Who you are in the kingdom, nobody can take that from you. Who you are in church, they can snatch you of your responsibilities. They can snatch you of your title. They can snatch you of your credentials and ask for them back because that's a church image. That's who you are. And a lot of us, you know, a lot of us don't have a life outside of church. You think I'm lying? Okay, so what happened last year when the pandemic started? All church services were shut down. Churches began to close. Some churches have not even opened yet. They're not even able to function anymore because the pandemic came and it took the stage and the performance away from what we call church. So if that was to happen, if you operated in who you were in the kingdom versus who you were in church, whether the pandemic came or not, you're still able to do what you've been called to do. Am I right? My brother say, huh?
If you're able to focus on who you are in the kingdom, you're still able to do that, right? Let me move on. Okay, so let's look at Jeremiah. Jeremiah 1 and 5 in the Message version of the Bible. It says, "Before I shaped you in the womb, I knew all about you. Before you saw the light of day, I had holy plans for you. A prophet to the nation. That's what I had in mind for you. Before you were even created, God had purpose and plan." Yes, you. Lesbian, homosexual, bisexual, whomever, whatsoever, hobby ever, whoever, however you identify yourself with, God had a plan for you. And he already knew who you were, what you liked, your faults, as well as your imperfections, your habits, everything. He knew all about you. So who you faking for? Right? Let's move on. Like I said, this image can't be taken away. The position can't be taken away. This title can't be taken away from you by no man, because you know who you are in the kingdom. Once you discover who you are in God, then you're able to own that thing and still walk in it. If you know who you are in God, nobody can hurt you. Nobody can discourage you and make you sit down in the back of the church when you know you're supposed to be sitting up there with the ministers. That's the difference. And I'm only talking about what I've experienced and what I've done. Once you discover who you are in the kingdom, the fear of losing everything will vanish. I promise you. It happened to me. I did it. Take control and be able to tell your own story, so there is nothing no one can out you with. You feel me? If you tell your own story, what is it left for anybody else to tell? That's why you have to live in your truth and be a little outspoken, because when you're very, very private, then people feel like it's their duty to report what they find out, the latest tea, the latest gossip, the latest dirt on you, when you're not living in your truth and you're hiding, what they call living in the closet. I didn't come out the closet. I just kind of confirmed what everybody thought all along. People assumed, based on my mannerisms sometimes, based on me not having a female on my arm, they kind of had their speculations, but nobody could really put their finger on it. Me, I always felt like the gay stamp was on my forehead. I felt like I was clockable. I felt like people could look at me and tell that I was gay. So, I mean, I didn't fake. I didn't act all masculine and stuff. I'm naturally masculine. I enjoy being a dude. So it wasn't that I wanted to be effeminate and wear makeup and all this other kind of stuff. That wasn't my story. That wasn't what I wanted to do. But people speculated. Yes, I was married. Yes, I had kids. God blessed me in my marriage to have 3 beautiful children. But people speculated. So I just confirmed what people already thought. In my opinion, who you sleeping with or the way you love has nothing to do with the ability to do the job in a ministry. When you live a respectable life, no question should be asked, in my opinion. If you live a respectable life and you're not out there, I mean, who applies for a position in church and say, "Hi, how are you doing? I'm Eric. I'm straight." Or "I'm a whore. And I sleep with multiple women at a time." Nobody does that. But if you are same gender loving, it's a problem. And I got a problem with that, because it's like you have a double standard. It's still a mess. Even if you're same gender loving and you don't know how to conduct yourself in your leadership position and you're sleeping with the people that you lead, that's still not a good look. Whether you're straight or gay, it's still not a good look. Why is it that people want to know off the bat if you gay when it comes to church stuff? Why is it your business? If it does not hinder you from doing anything in the ministry, I don't feel like it's nobody's business to talk about it. So it's one thing to live a life of discretion, but it's at some point you want to stop sneaking and looking over your shoulder. Who wants to live a sneaky, miserable life like that? Y'all, I'm telling y'all, I used to date guys and I would go to church and I would go through the back door and I'd tell them to go through the front. Or if we went to a musical or something, we didn't walk in together. I say, I'm going to go in first and then you come in 5 minutes later. For what? For what? I can't have friends? Even though that was my boyfriend, but I can't have friends? Why do I care so much about what people think and what come on now. That's all I'm trying to say. It's a lot of times, and I'm talking to the people who have yet to admit and live in their truth publicly. A lot of times, this pressure and this anxiety that we feel, it's in our head. Let me tell you something. Listen, ain't nobody checking for you like that. We think that everybody's going to know. They can look and tell by the way we walk in the door together that, oh, they must go together. People not checking for you like that. And to be honest, they really don't care. Unless you have a leadership position, unless you are in the hierarchy of a ministry or something like that, then yeah, they're trying to figure out who this person are. But a lot of times, if you're just a regular lay member, who you come to church with or who you leave with is the least bit of concern of anybody in your church, whether it's a big church or small church. You feel me? Moving on. I know so many men who know that they are same gender loving, and because of a position, you drag a woman into your foolishness and you end up injuring the woman and making her bitter because you refuse to accept the truth about you. It's so many guys who want to pastor and you know that you're same gender loving, but because you want this church, you're gonna meet a naive woman who's not going to really clock your tea, and you want to drag her into your foolishness because you know deep down that you don't like women like that. I almost said something. And women, you're not off the hook either. You're not off the hook either, because there are a lot of women, you know that this guy is gay. You know that this guy is a little suspect, like y'all say. But because you know that he's a preacher, you know that he's headed somewhere because of the position that you want as a woman, as a first lady. You want the red bottoms and the pink bottoms and the blue bottoms and the St. John, St. James and St. Matthews and all of that. You want to wear Jeffrey's Mark pieces and all of that kind of stuff. And you know that this dude play with boys. But you'll ignore that. You'll turn a deaf ear and a blind eye to that so you can hold this status. You like the clout of it. But then you want to play victim when he exposed y'all's secret. It happens every day. And a lot of our favorite religious organizations, it happens. Eric, what you talking about? There's a convention every year. I know a lot of bishops who get two rooms at the convention. I ain't trying to out nobody. I'm just telling the truth. I'm just telling y'all the truth. So, we don't have to do that. But you'll go get two rooms at the convention. One so you can play with the boys in, and then you got another room for your wife to come. Once she come 2 days later after the convention started, then that's y'all room together. So you got two rooms so you can play both sides of the fence. Why? And then you get up in the pulpit and you want to bash and say all this stupid, foolish stuff about the stuff that you struggle with within yourself. Why? Because you afraid to admit the truth about you. I'm just saying, y'all. Moving on. My issue with the whole arrangement of the marriage kind of thing. Women, and I'm just telling my testimony, y'all. A lot of this stuff is going to be based off of my experience and me being truthful about myself. I hurt a lot of women's feelings because they felt that I was gay because I hadn't met the right woman. You haven't met the right woman. So my question to them is, you really think that what you got between your legs is going to change me? You really think that your cooch is magical. You got the abracadabra. And once I get some of you, it's going to make me straight. No, precious. I'm so sorry. Be ever so encouraging. Carry the one. I know who I am. I hurt a lot of women's feelings because they just felt that I just didn't have the right female interaction. And I like the same thing you like. A lot of times, the same dude that was hollering at you was hollering at me too. Let's be clear. And you put yourself in that position. It's all kind of stuff that goes on, so I'm not putting the blame on nobody. But a lot of time, women, you know in the back of your mind. You know in the back of your mind. So it's really, it's kind of foul for you to play the victim and be embarrassed once his cover is blown. But as long as nobody could tell, as long as his tea wasn't getting out, you were fine. But the minute that it started becoming public knowledge, now you're embarrassed. But you knew when you said, I do. You knew when he proposed to you that it was something wrong. You knew something. It was something between him and that best friend. You knew it was something between him as a bishop and his adjutant. It happens. For whatever reason, I think men see being gay as being weak. I put that in my notes. A lot of guys see gay men as weak men. And that's not the truth. Because you're a man and you love another man intimately, that does not make you weak. You are not a faggot. You are not a sissy. You're not a cocksucker. You're not a carpet muncher, ladies. You're not a bulldagger. You're not a dyke. Or any of those derogatory, hateful names that they use to humiliate people. You're not that. You're not the scum of the earth. You're still a gay man. You're still a gay woman. And once you get that in your head and you own that thing and you don't look at yourself as an abomination, you don't look at yourself as sinful, you don't think that you're not abomination. You know that you're not going to hell. You've detoxed your mind and your spirit of all of this hypocritical jargon that people use to defend them their ignorance in church over the pulpit. You're not none of those things. The image of the black man is not the same image as it was decades ago. Y'all seen the movie Holiday Heart? Okay, so when I was little, that was the image of a gay man. Holiday was the image of a gay man. Most of the gay guys, they had the processes. I was born in 1974, y'all. Don't judge me. I know I still look good, but yeah, I've seen some things. And they had the processes, and later on they had the Jerry curls and all that kind of stuff. So it looked like you could tell that they were gay. You could tell that they were queer because of the way that they wore their hair, the way that they dressed and all that kind of stuff. That's not the image of a gay man now. Who wants to live a life of misery and loneliness because of the opinion of people who are afraid to admit the truth about themselves? Looking back on my life, even in high school, I was called a faggot. I was called a sissy. I was even called a pretty bitch. That was what they called me. I would walk down the hallway because I wore topsiders and topsiders, Sperry's, and penny loafers and all that kind of stuff. Every now and then I wear some sneakers. I had the whole Boys to Men thing, you know, the rayon shirts and the baggy pants, all that kind of stuff. That's what I wore to school every day. So I'd be walking down the hallway, and if I was by myself, and you know, you got these hateful guys, these athletes or whatever, in the hallway, and they felt like it was their business to humiliate me. So here come that pretty bitch. Okay. But what got me was the main people that were teasing me, the main guys that were humiliating me and bullying me. They call it bullying now. The main guys that were doing all of this foolishness in high school were the same guys that were trying to holler at me when I would go to Carrington's. I'm from Houston, Texas. So y'all know, if you're from Houston, you know what Carrington's was. I used to go to Carrington's. every weekend. And to be honest, that's where I would meet most of the guys that I talk to. Smitty's, all of that. Yo. Same guys that called me faggot, sissy, pretty bitch, all of that, were the same guys that were trying to holler at me after we graduated. You know, you done found me on social media. Oh, now you in my inbox. Oh, really? Not me. Not the pretty bitch. Not the faggot. No, not you. People that do the most, and I try to tell people this all the time, people that do the most teasing or showing the most, or the people that, the guys that show the most discomfort when you're around a gay man or a gay woman, are normally the people who are afraid to admit that their discomfort is the fear of them accepting the deep truth about themselves. I'm going to say that again. People that do the most teasing and showing the most discomfort when around another gay man or gay woman are normally the people who are afraid to admit that their discomfort is fear of them accepting the deep truth about themselves, which is why these same guys that tease me were at me once I got older and we were grown. Oh, now you want to talk about me, but you humiliated me years ago. I'm like, dude, get the hell out of my face. Get out my face, man. Because, and I'm not that type of person that just, you know, be in my feelings all the time. But y'all, those times really made me feel bad. It really made me have a little low self-esteem. And I'm a fighter. So it was kind of hard for me to kind of, you know, be in my feelings and stuff like that. Because I didn't mind fighting. And it hurt, y'all. It hurt. It did. Looking back on my life, those times really hurt me. It really did. Moving on. I talk about me some more. You have to gain the courage to embrace who you are. Once you own who you are, you have to also have courage and the willingness to cut off anybody that will stand in your way of owning your truth. Eric, what are you talking about? Sometimes you're going to have to walk away from your parents, grandparents, siblings, family, relatives, aunties, uncles, even friends. I thank God that my mom was so supportive of me. If y'all know me, y'all know, where you see me, you saw my mama. Where you saw my mama, you saw me when I was in Houston. And my mom has been so supportive day one. Once she and I had the conversation, my mom was supportive day one. I was still her baby. I was still her son. And my children, I'm still the apple of my kids' eye. My children see no wrong with me. I'm still their daddy. Once we had the conversation, my children were still so supportive of me. Me and my oldest daughter, Erin, we talk every day. I'm surprised she haven't tried to call me. She always called me on my live. Erin, don't call me. Call me later. But my kids have been supportive. So I don't have the testimony of my parents walking away from me. Yes, my dad, rest his soul, my dad called me a faggot. My dad told me that he disowned me. And in anger, he said this. And hearing him call me that name and telling me he disowned me was, oh my God, it was like somebody took my heart and just took a razor blade and just sliced it. I heard him the day he called me a faggot. The day he said that, I disowned your faggot ass from the beginning, were the words he used. I played that over in my head. Even when I didn't want to hear it, I heard it. And y'all, you know what? To show you just how God does things, my dad got sick and my dad needed someone to take care of him. And the faggot, the one he disowned, was the one that had to take care of him. I moved in. I dropped everything and moved in with my dad to take care of him. And my dad cried every day. Every day. I'm like, Dad, why are you crying? He had had strokes. And you know people that have strokes, one of their, what do you call it? Effects after the stroke is they're very emotional. Every time I did anything for my dad, he just cried. And one day I was like, Dad, why are you crying? He said, I never thought you would be the one that had to take care of me. And it was at that moment that I had to forgive him. And I said, Dad, you're my dad. You know, we ain't gonna worry about that. We're not gonna worry about none of that. Right now you need me and I'm here. And even on his deathbed, when my dad got ready to die, he knew he was dying. He called me to the bed. He said, I love you and I'm sorry. On his deathbed. So what am I supposed to do? This man trying to make peace with God and with peace with his family members. I had to forgive him. I had to forgive my dad. It hurt me. I cussed him out. If you know me, I did. If you know me very well, you know I did. If I can't do nothing else, I could put a whole sentence of cuss words together. And I cussed him out. I did. God is my witness because I was hurt. I never thought that my dad would do this. And I had to forgive him. Right there in that moment, I had to forgive my dad because I knew he was trying to make peace with God. So I don't have the testimony of my family walking away from me. I think I have an aunt that I don't even pay attention to who probably has an issue with my lifestyle. She's always had an issue with my lifestyle. And she always felt that it was her responsibility to try to ridicule me and check me when she thought that it was something else other than what she wanted me to be. I'll say that, say it like that. So even now, I mean, you know, people in my family, when I got ready to get married, there were people that I would have wanted to be there. And now that I look back on it, it's other people that I wish I would have invited, but I just didn't want to be at my wedding and didn't have the people that I knew were supportive of me there. I don't want people coming here to see. I don't want people looking a certain kind of way or whatever. So, I mean, you know, I wanted my sister there. My sister couldn't come. Yogi, she couldn't come because of something that was going on. My cousin couldn't come at the last minute. I couldn't afford to get my kids here. My son was here, but I couldn't afford to get my daughters here once we changed the venue and so forth. But the people that I knew were supportive of me were here. Talked to my niece the other day. My niece was like, I wanted to be there. And to this very day, right now, I still hate that I didn't tell her to at least give her the option to come or not come. But I didn't want rejection. I didn't want nobody to say, Eric, you know, I love you, but I can't come. I didn't want to hear that. I wanted some for sure answers. I wanted some for sure support. So I told those people that I knew supported me. In that moment, I knew that I wanted to invite them. So they were here. My best friend Didi was in my wedding. My son was in my wedding. My mom walked me down the aisle. My mom was supportive. And I thank God for that because a lot of people, once they start living in their truth, their parents don't know how to take it. They because it's not the image that they had for their child. Not that it's a bad thing. And I think at that time, that's when it's your duty to educate. If they're willing to learn, if they're willing to listen and learn how to love you in your truth, teach them. Teach them. A lot of parents don't even care. My mom just loves her son, period. My mom calls and talks to me, and she always asks about my husband. She said, where's my other son? My mother-in-law. She's always, when she comes over here for the weekend, she will sit right there. I send y'all little videos. She be watching Bishop Patterson on Sundays. She be sitting in the living room just in her own little world. If I have to go to work or something and I haven't come home, she asks my husband, where Eric at? What time he come home? It's getting late. Call and see how you doing. I mean, you know, love has no boundaries. Whether they understand or not, a lot of times when your parents are up in age, they just know what they know. And that's all. But if they love you, They will learn how to love you and accept you for who you are. Sometimes it take them a little while. And be willing to do that. However, if the person do not want to accept you for who you are, I hate to say this, but chunk them the deuce and write them off. Because you have to guard your peace and protect your peace and sanity at all cost. Even if it's walking away for a while. Sometimes they come around. Sometimes they realize, hey, you know what? I'd rather accept him for who he is so I could be around him and love him, or be around her and love her, than not be around him. So sometimes you got to just, you know, kind of weigh your options. You know, just find out what you're willing to give up. What are you willing to compromise with? You have to be willing to walk away from anyone that will stand in the way of your peace and your happiness. It's okay to be selfish. It's okay to be selfish for a season. Your happiness and your peace is the most important. Guard your peace. Once you begin to live in your truth and you're in this headspace where you can own who you are, the good, the bad, the ugly, don't let nobody come here with that church jargon and, well, you know, you're going to hell and out. Cut them off. People will cross the line and be disrespectful and keep being, hey, go somewhere and do something else. Go mess with somebody else. I'm not your topic of evangelism, so go get you some tracks and go on the street, because I'm not him. I know God for myself. Abel Shaddai. Moving on. Know what the word of God says about you. When people know that you don't know the word, when people don't know that you don't know the true meaning of the scripture, or if you don't show them that you know the true meaning of scripture, then they feel like that's their way to come in and challenge you and give you all. Well, the Bible says in Leviticus that man should not lay with man as a woman. That ain't what that mean. That's homosexuality is an abomination. That's not what that scripture mean. We got Hebrew, Greek, Aramaic. And when you go from that to King James, and go from King James to New King James, from New King James to NIV, from NIV to New Revised Standard, from New Revised Standard to the Message, and all, you get all of this stuff that's dropped. Interpretations that are dropped in scriptures, and people are putting in their opinion, and taking out what's needed and putting in that's what's not needed, and then you get a whole church full of confused people. Now the Bible say right here that man should not lay with man as a woman. That was a rule, that was a law that was given in Leviticus. Let me help you real quick. That was a law that was given in Leviticus that man should not lay with man as a woman, because the world was supposed to be reproductive. They wanted the women to get pregnant. They wanted the world to reproduce. And the men at that time were sleeping with their male servants, and they were not sleeping with their wives. So the women wasn't getting pregnant, because as good as it may feel, men cannot get pregnant. So the man can't reproduce. So the women wasn't getting pregnant. So the law was passed that man should not lay with man as a woman because of what was going on in that area, in the Bible. That's what that means. And a Bible scholar told me this in Houston, Texas, and I ain't gonna say his name. He told me this and schooled me real good. They was at the table playing spades at a friend of mine's house. And he said, Eric, that's not what that scripture means. That scripture means this. I was like, so why you don't preach what you found this truth to be? Because, Eric, I lose my church. Position, title, image. So you are the man of God that God has sent over this place, and you're not preaching the truth to these people? You know the truth, but you're going to preach it this way? You're going to have to answer to God. You got to answer to God for that, y'all. It's important that you learn the scripture. I mean, everything in the Bible ain't bad. Everything in the Bible ain't bad. But a lot of times when you use these scriptures for your personal gain, that's when you wound people. That's when you confuse people. And even you got to answer to God. for preaching false doctrine. Because that ain't what this scripture means. And you got these people walking out of church feeling humiliated and feeling bad and feeling low because you done sat here and preached a sermon according to the Bible that we're supposed to live by. And now I feel like I'm a sin. I feel like I'm an abomination. I feel like God don't love me. And it's a lie from hell. You're lying. And you have spirits and souls that are wounded. And you have to answer to God. So I just wish they had a me back when I was younger. I wish they had somebody like me that showed me that it was okay for me to accept who I was, who I felt I was on the inside. I didn't have nobody like that. Now, they taught me. They taught me how to live. But they taught me how not to be so promiscuous and fast. They didn't taught me how, they taught me that kind of stuff. But they didn't teach me how to live as a gay man. And I didn't know because I didn't know that it was cool for me to be the type of man that I am. I love being a man. I'm not gay because I want to wear nails and makeup and lashes and all that other kind of stuff to each his own. That's not my story. Be encouraged. I don't want that. I enjoy being a man. I'm too burly to be putting on anybody's heels. I'm not about to look like Holiday Hart or not Zima Jackson on 2-1-4. Yes, I will not. I enjoy being a man. I like having hair on my face. So that's not my story. But the image of a gay man is what you make it. The image of a gay woman is what you make it. There's no rules. There's no script that you have to live by that says, oh, well, you don't act gay. You're not gay, gay. Oh, this is the worst insult. Oh, you just a waste. What the hell you mean? Waste. I'm not a waste. I'm living in my truth. I'm living in who I am. I mean, last time I checked, all my bills are paid. All my needs are met with heaven's best. What do you mean a waste? God can't bless two men being married. Listen, let me tell you something. Eric Bernard Davis Jeffrey and Marcus Deron Davis Jeffrey, we have been nothing but blessed since we've been together. Before we said I do, God gave us favor. So if God can't bless it, I don't want to see him not blessing it because right here, if I show you my house, if you've been to my house, we live a blessed life. And we are same gender loving, 2 Holy Ghost filled, tongue talking, 5 baptized believers. Hey, Aaron, I told y'all my baby was going to be on here. Hey, Nana. So listen, I'm almost done. Know the word of God, what the word of God says about who you are. There are people that know that you know that will try and challenge you, as I said, and throw the Bible in your face and say that you're an abomination and say that your lifestyle is a sin and so forth. You have to know the word of God for yourself. Stand firm on what you know about the truth in the Bible and don't back down. I mean, you don't have to sit there and argue and go back and forth with people. Because once you know, well, the Bible say this, I'm going to just say this one time. That's not what the scripture means. That scripture means such and such and such and such. If they don't want to hear and they want to keep saying, well, what about this? Listen, I'm okay with who I am. If you got a problem with that, that's your problem. You got the issue. I don't have the issue. I'm fine. I'm going to sleep every night. I'm not stressed. I'm not worried. So know what the Bible says about your step and stand firm on what you believe, to know what the truth is. Keep boundaries and make it extremely uncomfortable for people to overstep their bounds with you. Make it, whatever you got to do. Listen, I got a mean mug that ain't no joke. I have a look on my face, and I hate that sometimes you can see or read my facial expressions, but I have this image on my face to let you know, listen, don't come play with me. Whatever you got to do, set boundaries with people. Don't come trying to challenge me. I'm not for it today. Go on about your day. Don't try to challenge me because I already know. Listen, I'm not for that today. I came to get my hair cut and I'm going home. I came to sit here and support such and such and I'm going home. Hey, set boundaries. This is mostly the reason why some gay men or some gay women seem to have a chip on their shoulder. You always want to know why. If you talk to someone who's gay or whatever and you ask them something, they immediately snap. Because at some point you get tired of having to argue and justify yourself. You're tired of being disrespected. You're tired of people trying to challenge you. And all you coming to do is get your hair done. All you coming to do is get your hair cut. All you coming to do is get your nails done, get your mani-pedi, something like that. That's it. But folks want to... Why? Are you gay? Why do you want to know this? Why you keep asking me the same questions every time you see me? Let me find out. You trying to join the Rainbow Coalition. Know who you are and set boundaries for people. Set boundaries for people and whatever you got to do. Meme mug, whatever, y'all. Because sometimes people do the most. They do the absolute most. And it's just, I mean, it's just a lot. If you ask an honest question the wrong way, you might get your head chopped off. Because some people are just tired. You never know where a person is. They probably could just left home having an argument with a family member or whatever. And you see them with that foolishness and they go completely off on you. That's why. It's not that they got a chip on their shoulder. It's not that they mad. But sometimes you just get tired of people always testing you and pushing buttons just to get a reaction. The whole you gay, oh my God, you away statement. That's so disrespectful to me. That's so disrespectful. Oh, you too pretty to be gay. So gay people supposed to be ugly? Oh, you too sexy to be gay. So the gay men was just supposed to be flower girls? Why? Why we can't have good looking gay men? Why we can't have good looking gay women? Why? Why we got to have the trash or the scraps? No. I'm made in the image of God. And you have to know that you're made in the image of God and in his likeness. So why am I a waste if I'm made in the image of God? You got to go there with people. You got to go there. I'm perfectly and wonderfully made for the love that I have to give. So I'm not a waste at all. But I'm wasting my time by talking to you. That's what I put. So, own who you are. Know what the word of God says about you. Be willing to walk away from anybody, any relative, anybody, for a season or for good, if they can't respect who you are. Don't allow people to continue to walk over you. You tired of people walking over you? Get off the floor. You're tired of people walking all over you? Get off the floor. Set boundaries with people. Don't let people come in and disturb your peace, disturb your joy, your zen. Don't let people do that. You got to know the word of God for yourself. The moment that you show any type of signs of weakness, people automatically assume, oh, see, yeah, he not for sure about it. He not for sure about it. It's just a phase you're going through. No, I'm 40-something years old. I'm past phases. It's not a phase. This is who I am. And I need you to be okay with that. If not, be encouraged. I wish you well. But this is where I'm going. It's my mission is to get the people that have a calling and a mandate on their life. I want to get them off of the back pew. I want to get them off of the bleachers and get them on the sidelines so you can get in this game. God has need of you. Man of God, God has need of you. Woman of God, God has need of you. And the way you love has nothing to do with the call and mandate on your life. I'm going to keep saying that until y'all get it. I've heard so many stories about people that, Damien, I'm almost 47. May 27th, I'll be 47 years old. I'll be 47 years old, May 27th. I have heard so many stories, y'all, about, I mean, horror stories, stories that will really make you cry, about how people have been asked to leave churches and so forth and taken out of position in churches because they want to live in their truth. And I get it. I get it. If that goes against your bylaws and the rules of your church, I promise you there's a church for you. I promise you there is a ministry that you can serve in that your sexuality, the way you love, will not be a problem. And all of them are not affirming ministries or not gay churches or inclusive churches, however y'all want to voice it. All of them are not those churches. Some there are some churches, like the church that I grew up in, that it's a church where everybody is somebody. And your pastor preaches a word of love and conviction to you without beating you up. There are churches like that. And there were several churches. There are pastors who will stand by you and affirm you like my bishop has for me. So y'all, I'm just what I'm on this season. I mean, you know, y'all pulled this out of me, so here I am. This is what I'm doing because I wouldn't trade nothing for my journey. I really wouldn't. It was hard. It was very hard. I was mad at God. I was talking to a friend of mine earlier today about this, and we were talking about our path, and it was hard because I was mad at God because of what I was taught. I hadn't detoxed everything that I was taught. So, and I'm not talking about my childhood pastor. I learned this stuff as I got older, what the Bible said about homosexuality, and it was abomination and all this other kind of stuff. And I started feeling bad, and I would feel defeated when I would meet somebody and we would have sex and we would be intimate and all that kind of stuff. On my knees praying and repenting all over again and beat myself up every time I fail. And I was trying to fight a battle that I didn't have to fight. But I didn't know what the word of God said about that. So everything people told me over the pulpit, everything people told me on the side after church was over, you know, these little outhouse prophets and parking lot prophets and all that kind of stuff. People saying stuff and make you feel bad about who you are. When they see you out with somebody and they kind of figure out that that's the person you dating, they want to say little sly stuff to you and all that kind of stuff. I didn't know what the word of God said about me. So I was beating myself up. I was depressed because I kept going to the altar and crying out to God and I wasn't changing. I kept turning women away in my walk to try to pray the gay away because I thought I was going to hell and I thought I wanted to be right. And I was confused because I'm like, God, I know that I'm gay and I know how I've been feeling toward the same sex. And you want to call me to preach? How you going to call me to preach? And as far as I can remember, I've had these desires. As far as I can remember, I had these feelings toward boys and men. And I'm going to hell? Well, I got this anointing. You didn't gifted me to play the piano at 7 years old without no lessons. I've been singing before I could talk. I got all these gifts, all this anointing, and I'm going to hell? But it wasn't the God that I knew. It was the God that I was taught. And that's not who God is. All of this stuff that they beat me up with, I went through all of that. And I had to go through it because it gave me the fervor and the fire that I have now to minister to y'all. Y'all, listen, bro, sis, be who you are and have peace about it. Please, please, I beg you, find peace with who you are. Enjoy the latter days of your life. Don't live a lonely, miserable life for the sake of some folks that don't have a heaven or a hell to put you in. I'm happily married. I love my husband and I love him publicly. I don't mind dressing like my husband. I don't mind hugging my husband and kissing my husband and giving him public praises to people because I know who I am. And if it's uncomfortable for you, kick rocks. For whatever reason, people that don't affirm or feel good about same-sex, they don't support same-gender couples or whatever, for whatever reason, even if they don't, for other people, for whatever reason, they love us. And I'm okay with that. It's wrong to be kind of hypocritical or one-sided. You'll do it for this couple, but you don't like this couple over here. But if we're used to educate and teach people that this is real, our marriage is real, that's cool. That's cool. We accept that wholeheartedly. If we're used to be the training ground to teach you that our marriages can be blessed, our marriages are real, our marriages go through anything else that you go through in your heterosexual marriage, we got the same thing. The same thing you want in your marriage, we want in ours. It's no different. Our love is still genuine. Our love is still real. I love my husband. I love him. I couldn't live without my husband. Eric, you putting him before God? No, I'm not. Because you wasn't here when he was intubated in March last year. And he was on the ventilator for 3 days. You wasn't here when he had a heart attack in November. And he could have died. His artery was blocked 100%. He could have died. He could have died laying in the bed next to me. He could have died here sewing for y'all in the sewing room by himself while I was at work. And the thought of me losing somebody that I finally found that loves me for me, there's a genuine love that I have with this man. We have a beautiful life together. I was like, God, no, this can't be. We just got married. No, you can't take it from me now. I finally got the guts to be who I am and live in my truth. No, this cannot be over now. No, please, no. You can't do this to me. I beg God and I rebuke death. And my husband is still here. Y'all wouldn't know what to do with me had this man left me. I'm so serious. Y'all wouldn't have known what to do with me. So I thank God that I'm able to love out loud. I'm able to embrace who I am in God, and I'm able to minister to people and show them that God still loves them and God still can use you. Whatever I can do to help, please call me. Please inbox me. I'm here. I'm here to serve. I've been saved to serve. I've been called to serve, to help people. That's what I want to do. And so y'all hit me up anytime. I got hit up for speaking engagements and all that kind of stuff. Whatever I got to do to get the good news out, that's what I want to do. Call me. You can hit me up in my inbox, on Instagram, Facebook, or whatever. I don't have a business number. If you got my personal number, call me. If you need it, inbox me and I'll give it to you so we can set up. I'm a life coach. So if this is the area that I have to be your life coach in to get you and walk you through that, I'm willing to do that. Hit me up. It might cost you a little something, but I'll still help you. This is my livelihood. This is my ministry. So I'm willing to do that for anybody who needs help. Please be a blessing to the ministry. My cash app is $ericbdavis. Eric B. Davis. $ericbdavis is my cash app. Somebody put that up there again for me, please. Tamika, what? Wow. I'm glad you're still here. I'm glad you're still here, sis. I really am. Wow. Thank y'all so much for this time you spent with me. Please share this live. Share with somebody. Please share with somebody who may need to hear it. You know somebody that has kind of lost their zeal for ministry because of the way that they treated them once upon a time. If you know somebody, send this to them. I'm going to save this to YouTube, and you can send them the YouTube link or send them to me so I can minister to them. God has need of you, and there's a people that are waiting to hear the word of God from your mouth. It's not going to stick the same because it has to come from you. And if it doesn't come from you, these people's lives are stagnant because you are not in place. God bless you.
God bless you. God bless you. I love all of you. Thank you guys for tuning in. I still got 26 people. Thank y'all so much. I will see y'all next week. We're going to talk some more. We're going to talk some more. Next week, we're going to be talking about some other stuff. I also want to do outreach. I want to make sure that our same gender loving people, people that are HIV positive and you don't know how to get in care. You don't know what Ryan White is. You don't know what ADAP is. And you probably scared to go to the doctor or whatever. I want to hook you up with the right people so you can still live. Just because you're HIV positive don't mean that it's a death sentence. You don't have to die from HIV. You die from HIV if you want to die from HIV. There are too many people living beautiful, fruitful lives. And if you looked at them, you wouldn't be able to tell that they're positive or undetectable. I want to make sure that you're getting care. If you live in Atlanta, if you live in Houston, I got connections there too. You in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, my brother Marvin Anderson is there and he can connect you with the people to get you in care. All you got to do is say, I need help, and I guarantee you, I'll get you the help. All right? Y'all be blessed.